So hi everyone, I'm Sadie. I've chosen cracks as my symbol. I was really interested in their ability to change and shape the objects they affect. There's something that happens to other representations, other statues, but they also change the trajectory of what those symbols represent. I was really interested in them not only as signs of damage, but also as memorials to trauma meant to be witnessed and acknowledged. I don't believe that art requires pain or suffering, but I do use my art to engage with things that haunt me. In many instances, something that's been cracked open can never return to its original state. Even if the object is repaired, that crack is now a part of its story, and I wanted to view fissures and gaps as pathways, portals, and transformations. And this slide is just, some of my inspiration that I found when I was researching. This larger piece right here is art using the method called kintsugi, which, is a way to repair pottery with melted metal, gold to try to like make it more beautiful, but I thought it was a really interesting representation of the way that cracks can alter symbols. And then this next slide is just showing a bit of my process before my final piece. Some exploration I did, and I'm going to speak more about the piece in the middle. So in Korea, when someone has died, their name is inked into red in an official registry, so it's something of a taboo to sign your name in red before you die. I'm a third generation Korean American, so I don't pay attention to that. I have really absentmindedly signed my name in like cheap red ballpoint pens more times than I can count. And every time I do, sometimes I feel a bit of loss. Like my lack of fear is a sign that I'm inauthentic. And to me, that forgetfulness has kind of come to represent a disconnect and distance from my heritage. And then, so this final piece that I've created is a diptych, and it's titled In Loving Memory. I'll give some more context now. You can see on the left that panel is an amalgamation of my initial pieces exploring that concept. I thought it was fitting to have my signature cut open like a symbol of death to be construed as an opening or portal to the underworld. And then the second panel I've created is a piece of writing that I wrote, two separate texts that I've written on breaks and cracks of some kind intercut with one another, and they're alternating. So I'll read a short excerpt from each text. So the first one I've written is called Imposter Syndrome in Immigrant Story, and I'll read an excerpt from it now. I think that I've become more susceptible to whiteness because of how I'm growing up. How could I not? I eat, breathe, sleep, listen to, live whiteness. I think I've become more porous, more absorbent, and it seeps into my bones with every passing moment. Or maybe this is how I've always been, inundated with it. Soaking in it, drowning in it. That is what assimilation is, drowning, unable to come up for air, unable to breathe, suffocating. Assimilation was always a birthright, a predetermined outcome, the conclusion of my family's story of the American dream. I have always been drowning because although the sea does not try to kill sailors who tumble in, it does anyway. It kills them not because it wants to, the sea has no wants. It kills them because it has to, because that is its nature. We drown. Waves cover our bodies. We become invisible. We have always been invisible. And then the second piece that I've written is titled In Remembrance. I don't want to hold your hands, but I would like for mine to not be empty. I think it would make up for the fact that they are mine. And so I do as break begets break, widening in the space we could not see when it was filled with a cold sheen of porcelain and before it began to fracture. Is this space a portal? A void, an abyss? Is it evidence of a drought of some mask since broken? More likely, it is a sorry memorial to a wound inflicted before the cast was set, a fault line beneath the surface lying in wait. Thank you all so much for your time. I'm happy to answer any questions or hear any thoughts if anyone has any, but otherwise, I'll leave this up for another minute.
Okay, so my symbols are ravens and crows. And for like a note of clarification, ravens and crows are actually like distinct creatures, but like in this presentation, I'll be using them interchangeably for the purpose because like they both like symbolize really similar things and they're both like perceived in really similar ways. So I'm just gonna like leave that there. So moving on, I have my artist statement. So my artist statement is quite long, so like I feel like I shouldn't really read it, but like I'm gonna just gonna hit like the main points that like my artist statement addresses. So as introduction, like, hi, I'm Alice, I'm from Brooklyn, and like art has been like a really lifelong hobby of mine. So like I'm always like looking for ways to explore it more. And the symbol I chose for this final project is the crow or raven, because like I've been always curious about why these creatures have been like deemed as like bad omens, and like I always thought that there's something more to it. So like I'm really happy to explore and like do research on them. And like in my research, like I discovered that like depending on where you're from and like where you live, people perceive these creatures differently. Like some demonize it and some respect it, while others kind of see like them as a bit of both good and bad. And like for instance, in Norse mythology, like crows and ravens are like considered as like symbols of insight and wisdom, because they're associated with the god of wisdom Odin, whereas in Greek mythology they're considered as more of like bringers of bad news, because there's a story about how like a raven brought like bad news to the god Apollo. So like overall, like these creatures can symbolize anything from affection, death, light, darkness, cunning, messages, subversion, and wisdom. And lastly, I'll be going through like the different parts of my piece. I'll just like go through my thought process and the media I use and like explanation for like different aspects of my piece. So like that's probably gonna cover like the rest of the presentation. So yeah. So part one is like the outer gate. So like I did like a foldable. So like on the front flaps are like two gates, and the media I use for like this front piece are ink alcohol markers and small bird cutouts. And as you can see from like the photographs, there's two opening gates, and they're done in minimal color, which is like black, white, and gray, because like I want to use like the lack of color to really like point at the superficiality of like looking at things from the surface. And hence we have like the unopened gates and like the lack of color in one perspective. And this like when you open this, it leads to like, okay, so like it's kind of like, okay, never mind. So like have like progress photos, as you can see, like progress, but yeah, like it leads into like this, which is like something within the gates. And in like the second page, just like dividing tree, I'm still using the same mediums, but like I incorporated more colors because you can really see that like the colors is like kind of denoting like a more like open way of thinking, that they're like considering like two different perspectives. And there's like a tree that divides both of them, because in some cultures, the tree can often symbolize a division between different realms, and like they're kind of like a bridge that kind of like joins two separate sides. So that's why I included the tree in this piece. And yeah, it just like kind of just shows that like people can like consider and accept different perspectives. And then finally, when you open the whole thing, you get this, which is like, I guess, the innermost piece. And this is like a painting, like done in acrylic and metallic markers, which is like around the bird. So like the majority of the piece has like this kind of like angry cloud that's like kind of like trying to like capture the bird, but like the bird is actually like trying to escape free from the cloud, because it shows that like the crow is like breaking away from the stereotypes that like people has like enforced on them. So like while creating this, like I had like one word in mind, which is like the word free, because in general birds are often associated with like freedom. So like that's just like the idea I really wanted to capture in this piece. So you see like the bird escaping is like kind of like a way of like achieving freedom from stereotypes. And then there's like a different photo because the scan version and the photo version are sometimes like really different. So I've included both. Progress photos. I mean, they're not really progress photos, but like I give like photos in my workspace. They're like kind of messy. There's like there's like a dirty paint palette, and yeah. And then here's a thank you slide. So if anyone has any questions, so like feel free to jump in, and thank you for like coming to this presentation and just like see what all of us has created.
So yeah, hi, thank you so much for coming. My name is Leiwei and I'm a high school student. I live in Brooklyn with my family, but I was born in Azerbaijan. And the symbol I chose for this piece was fire. So to start off, I chose this symbol on the first day I attended the program. When I was doing the collage piece, which was on the first day, I was mainly drawn to cooking images. So as you can see here, but Aurélie helped me connect it back to fire since it was the fundamental base of cooking, but it also held like many other meanings. So typically fire has a lot of symbolism and can be depicted in positive and negative light. So some believe fire represents destruction, like hell, but it's also seen as a passion, desire, rebirth, hope, and even wisdom. And so for the next few slides, we were on the fifth day of the program, we were supposed to finalize our selection of the symbol. So we were asked to make five pieces using different mediums just to help push us make the decision. So I decided to show the five on the next few slides. Here's the first one. And I decided to stick with fire during this assignment because it has personal meaning to me as well. So as I mentioned in the beginning, I'm from Azerbaijan, but I moved here when I was 3 years old. And Azerbaijan is known to be the land of fire. And a fun fact is that Azer in Farsi also means fire. So it just further pushes this connection. And I didn't realize how connected my country was to fire. And there's an interesting history that goes behind it. And it was because my country has a lot of oil and natural gases, they would rise to the top of the surface and there would be casted fires that would burn for very long periods of time, and which led people to believe they were some sort of eternal flame. And basically, this being part of my culture, it made me want to pick the symbol even more. But another thing is, I'm a Leo and the element is fire. So again, just really wanted to make me pick it. But that's enough about my personal connection. In other cultures, the meaning of fire really differs a lot as well. For example, in Christianity, angels use their flaming swords to guard the Garden of Eden, but also seen in the Old Testament of Daniel, where flaming wheels were shown around God's head. Also represents God's existence when Moses was receiving the Ten Commandments. And it just shows that fire has always been a natural and big part in the fundamentals of everything. And it shows its duality with being a creator and destroyer. Indigenous belief systems also had sacred fire rituals like the Celts. One of the rituals is on May 1st when they would roll flaming wheels down hillsides to keep, they would believe that it would help to keep fires burning in order to give warmth and for cooking. In ancient Greek tales, there's a story about Prometheus who took a fire in a fennel sock from Olympus to give to human beings, and it resulted in his torture by Zeus. Another example is Aztec culture, where Mixcoatl became the god of fire, by being able to percussion lightning and invent the fire drill. And it's believed he gave fire to humanity. And a final example is in Hinduism, where people, you know, use fire in their rituals and prayers, and they use it to pray to Agni and ask for his protection, who's a fire god. So it's just with all this knowledge and all this, interesting facts and connections I made with fire, I decided to make this final piece, which is on the next slide. So here it is. I wanted to include the many different aspects of what I learned about this symbol and give it personal meaning too. So the three flames on the sides, meant to represent the flame towers that are in Baku, which is the capital of Azerbaijan. The line is to show the connection between the fact that I'm a Leo and it's the element, and its element is fire. And also the fact that the lion is a symbol for Leos, which is why it's on the bottom on the rocks. And the center with the hand with the fire is to show how it's present in everything. And that's why it's the only one shown in its actual form and surrounded by the other elements, which are represented kind of like logos in a way. So yeah, this was my presentation on the symbol of fire. Thank you so much for listening. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to ask or say anything.
I'm Jasmine, I'm 17. I live in Nassau County. I do art, and yeah, it's like my symbols were roses and butterflies. So wait, oh, hang on. Okay. So I've been doing art, like advanced art, at high school for over 3 years, and with my art teacher, Mr. Antonori. He was my art teacher. And for my career, I kind of want to keep going on that path. I want to do art therapy. I want to do counseling, something with psychology, because I think that art just has such, has such a change on the mind. It just puts it in such a state that, you know, it just changes you for completely. So these are some of my works. As you can see, this one has some roses, like the portrait. This one was with acrylic paint. My original symbol was supposed to be roses, but I changed it later to butterflies. The next one is, this was a tarot card sketch that we had to do. I think this one was I forgot the name of it, but it's the
Maria star card.
Yes, the star. And the other one was we had a workshop where we had to, we were making clay sculptures, and I really liked it. And I think it was around that time when I was like, oh, I want to do butterflies. But at the same time, I really liked making roses as well. So I was like, I wanted to incorporate both of them. But mostly, mainly, my work is butterflies for my final piece. So the symbolism in butterflies is like cultural. It has a lot of cultural significance. Like, in some cultures, it's like a family member passing away, or it could symbolize happiness and some of the gods, like in Aztec and Incan culture or Mayan culture. I'm pretty sure that some of the gods are represented by butterflies, like different statues, different like elements. Shaped like butterflies, represent different gods or deities. For Christians and Indigenous cultures, it's once again state of bliss or happiness or resurrection. And also the color of the butterfly wings are pretty significant as well. So white is good luck, yellow is hope, black could be sickness or disease. And for some cultures, the stages of a butterfly's life, the metamorphosis cycle, is parallel to the spiritual transformation of one person. Like when we are having a spiritual transformation, we are excluding ourselves from the outside. We are just in our own space, in our own body. Our cocoon is basically our physical body. And that is how we compare the stages to us. So another thing before I get into the piece is that butterflies are also a symbol of, I'm sorry, my birds are loud. Butterflies are symbolized dreams. And by that, basically the main type of dream, I guess, that a butterfly represents is a dream that there's going to be change, like a sudden change. And that change is going to disrupt your life, whether it's good or bad. But no matter what kind of change it is, you just have to embrace it. You just have to let it flow within you and let it guide you to where your next place is going to be. So for me, I was like, I had that change, that sudden change to transform my piece into a completely different drawing, something that I didn't think I was going to do, because I did think I was going to do roses, just completely. Just that transformation into butterflies was something that, like, I kind of thought was like interesting. So the piece that I did was this. And the reason I did it was I realized that when roses are blooming, like the buds kind of looked a little bit like a caterpillar cocoon or like the chrysalis of the butterfly. I thought that was cool. So I kind of made it like, I kind of meshed the two together to make it look like it's a rose butterfly. So the butterfly has like rose petal wings, and that was my whole idea. And I had like, this was something that we did in my art class, like around the summertime, which was we had to do a project where we had to choose an object, an inanimate object from nature, and we had to use it in like a spiral motion. We had to give it like depth, even though it was 2D. So you can see like this white part is like the outline of like an actual rose. And, you know, inside of those, inside is the like the, you know, like the metamorphosis. And it's supposed to represent the different stages and, you know, out comes the butterfly in the last one. So that's kind of what I was thinking of. And what I used for the actual art piece. So first I like went over with alcohol markers, and then I overlaid it with gouache, which is like kind of watercolor paint, but it's also, it's much more thicker. And then for the butterflies and the leaves and like the flowers, I did with chalk, and it was a bit messy, but I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I just like, I really liked how the piece came out. And because not only was I like transforming the piece, I felt like I was also going through a transformation of where I was switching up a style. Like that is something that we've always discussed, that we have to try out different styles. So I thought that, like, you know, why not try different symbols? And I also did a digital version of it. This was the digital counterpart. This was more of a reference sort of thing, that this was like my guide to making the actual art piece on canvas. But I still wanted to like include it because I still thought that it was really good, in my opinion. And yeah, so then this is a song that I thought is kind of like, this is,
okay, listen up. Is buying this place thoughts? Negative me.
No.
Should have started with you. Spontaneous.
Do you want me or do you not? I heard one thing. Now I'm hearing another. Dropped a pin to my parking spot. The bar was hot. It's 2 a.m. It feels like summer. Happiness is a butterfly. Try to catch it like every night. It escapes from my hands into moonlight. Every day is a lullaby. Vomit on the phone like every night. Sing it for my babies on the tour. A serial killer, that was the worst that can happen to a girl who's already hurt. I'm already hurt. If he's as bad as they say, then I guess I'm cursed. Looking into his eyes, I think he's already hurt.
Bye.
So hi everyone, I'm really excited to be sharing my final project with everybody. So for this project, I chose water as my symbol because it's a symbol that's personal to me in a way that, since my name Dalma means water droplet in Turkish and I'm Scorpio, which is a water sign. So therefore I want to combine these two concepts and create a project dedicated to astrological water signs, Scorpio, Pisces, and Cancer, since I'm really interested in astrology. And while researching about water as a symbol, I learned that universally water is symbolic of purity, fertility, life, motion, renewal, and transformation. And the symbolism of water comes from its two vital qualities, which is that it's most essential for existence and it cleanses and purifies things by washing away impurities. So yeah, now I'll share my screen. Can you see it? Okay. So first I just want to show my progress. So I did three separate ones. This is what my process looks like. And I actually did it digitally on Procreate. So that's why it looks really clean, I guess. Anyways, and yeah. So I want to give a quick little information about each sign, like fun little facts. So let's start with Pisces. So Pisces, are there any Pisces, by the way? Yeah. So Pisces are known as the most artistic of all the zodiac signs, and they frequently explain their creativity in everyday life. They have strong imaginations, and their reputation as dreamers can help them when they pursue hobbies such as art, music, and writing. And they aren't that bound by logic as many other signs, and their openness to new ideas allows them to explore creative avenues others may overlook or dismiss it. And yeah, so for Cancers, for the next sign. For Cancers, Cancers are extraordinarily protective of loved ones and sometimes even to a fault. They deeply cherish family and close friends and will often go out of their way to protect their loved ones no matter what cost. And because the Cancer sign is strongly tied to the image of home, crabs will go extreme lengths to protect their homes and those in them. So it's similar to a parental instinct. And yeah. So for Scorpios, Scorpios are known to be fierce. They are single-minded in achieving their goals, and they set those goals really high, and Scorpios don't see or set limits in their life, and they don't let anyone tell them that something they want isn't possible. So now to the symbolic meaning of each sign. Let's again start with, let's start with Cancer. So Cancer, which is represented as the crab, is a cardinal water sign, and it represents clarity, purity, trust, refreshment, and regeneration. The crab's shedding of its shell for a new one represents the rebirth or renewal aspect of water and its contentment to flow with the natural cadence of water represents motion and trust. So for Scorpio, which is the scorpion, it's a fixed water sign. Water deals with the subconscious and holds endless mysteries like the obscure world thriving inside vast murky oceans. And the Scorpio associates with water to symbolize stillness, reflection, and mystery. For Pisces, it's the fish, and it is mutable. It is a mutable water sign and representative of life, motion, depth, and understanding. Water is believed to contain knowledge of the infinite unknown and is known to be the source of life. And as a water symbol, the fish represents wisdom, creativity, and fertility. So yeah, and the reason why I chose skeletons was because, first of all, I got most of my inspiration from Maria and her artwork, like how she uses that form in all of hers. So I wanted to combine those two because since water is symbolic for refreshment and rebirth and Another thing is that death is a universal symbolism of the skeleton in all human cultures. And we often notice skeletons becoming a symbol of life, the opposite of death, as in like ancient hunter-gatherer societies. And the skeleton was considered a place where the soul was indwell. And nevertheless, more fundamentally, it symbolizes death, which I thought they were such opposites that I wanted to connect them because I thought it was super interesting. And yeah. That's all.
Thank you. So hi everyone, my name is Chris. I'm from the Bronx and I'm 16 years old, so I'm a rising junior. I chose the moon as my symbol, and the reason for that is because it's connected to my mom. She has the moon everywhere in her home, so I see it every day, no matter what. And because of that, it's become a really personal symbol to me, since whenever I look at it, it reminds me of my own mother. And so originally I didn't plan on doing the moon because I thought it would be too predictable of myself. I wanted to try to do something different that maybe I didn't have any previous knowledge on, but I decided that with this symbol, I would be able to research more passionately. So for what I learned, I learned that it represents immortality, rebirth, purity, and femininity. But on the flip side, it can also represent masculinity and even slaughter. There's a lot of gods and goddesses that I learned about too throughout my research. So most of them are actually goddesses. But the main ones that I focused on were Selene and Luna. Luna is a Roman goddess and Selene is the Greek. So for my final piece, I actually created a sculpture. We started that in a workshop, but I wanted to add on to it a little bit more. I create a painting to go along with it, and some of the photos I took, it's not present, but I took photos out during the nighttime, so it would kind of enforce the moon-like symbol. I'm going to be playing music, so I won't be talking in a moment, so I'm going to screen share now. So for context, it's supposed to be a mother holding the moon because of my mom. It's supposed to in some way represent myself and my own memory of her. So I wanted to add imperfections to it. It's not supposed to be perfect because it's supposed to represent me and my own memories of my mom. So so thank you for listening to me. Thank you for this amazing opportunity. And if you have any questions, you can ask.
Hi everyone, my name is Soleil and I'm 16 and I'm from Brooklyn and I'm going to screen share for you all. So here's my presentation I have to go to. Okay, so my symbol, I ended up going with togetherness because I think my collage had a lot happening in it and I kind of just felt drawn to thinking about. So this is a collage, this is how things come together. And I had a lot of different groups of people and maybe herds of animals and different things happening. So I kind of felt like it was a culmination of just things coming together. Over the past 2 weeks, I've been able to intuitively weave symbolism into each art piece I've made. The symbol I landed on in the program was togetherness, which I just said. And I think just a little bit about it, when I first decided this was my symbol, I think it was kind of like I was just thinking so much about the pandemic. And I was kind of thinking, okay, it's great I chose togetherness because it's been kind of a lonely year. It's been kind of a disconnected year. And I think that a lot of the research I was doing at the beginning of this being my symbol had to do with loneliness and had to do with what I kind of interpreted right away as the opposite as togetherness, and immediately looking at togetherness as a positive thing. So for my final piece, I kind of just looked at togetherness as this coming together of a bunch of different things. So you'll see what I talk about, and you can read this. And on the right, this drawing I did, I think really helped me to think more about my symbol and to realize that togetherness is really just like things coming together to create something bigger. So then I started focusing on groups of people and and what that means and how individuals make up groups and different numbers of people and what that means, and thinking about positive togetherness versus negative togetherness, and then researching individualism and what that means and how that shifts when people are put into groups. So then I decided for finding community, that was a positive side of togetherness. I did a really light drawing because I think that finding community is something really important and really great, especially on the surface. And I was also inspired by Charles Ewan, the artist who came in to speak to us, because one of his pieces was about surface level interpretations of things. And I think that community from the outside, from someone who's alone, seems like a really good thing to be a part of. And this drawing was also inspired by a piece I saw in the archives called, it didn't have a title, but it was a medieval family around a hearth. And I have these three figures with their hands over a fire, all warming themselves and each other in a way, because they're united together at the fire. And then I just have another picture of it. And then here I did this drawing, and this is about codependency. So when togetherness goes too far, when it becomes something unstable and less reliable, and kind of these figures melding into each other in a way that they can't separate, that's actually kind of destabilizing and painful. And then, that got cut off. I think that's mass conformity. So then we have these same kind of three individualists who have gone in to join the masses in a way that kind of just like swallows their soul. And I was watching a lot of videos and researching kind of, this is grim, but the direction that the world's going in with technology and with so many chains and so many commonalities within the world, and kind of seeing that like in the next like thousands of years or hundreds of years, whatever, how we're kind of all leaning into being like one global culture. This is just a closer look. And then this is also a closer picture of what ended up being kind of, so I made a bunch of drawings for my final piece that are different stages of individualism when connected to togetherness. So this is kind of the final idea of togetherness in a way that I think could be better than the individual being lost through conformity to a system or ideas. So then this piece, I also decided to use color. A bunch of people who are kind of supporting each other. And I also was trying to play with the idea of the shadow, because I think that's something I really liked when I was thinking about togetherness, because your shadow is always accompanying you places, and you're never alone because that's there. And I was kind of thinking of these individuals as each other's shadows, so they don't have to be in each other's way, blocking their individuality, but they're there to kind of protect or to be there so that they're not alone. So then they have the surface level idea that securing of togetherness, but they're also still allowed to be individuals. And then so this is what I was trying to figure out how to do, but you can still see, okay. So I hope you can still see the crepe piece, but another aspect of my final piece that I decided to do was because I have so many ideas and opinions about individuality and togetherness and collectiveness and collectivism. So I took all of my notes and I put them into this software where you write sheet music. And then I took all the music letters, music notes from the words, and then put it into this piece. And it was initially for piano, but then I realized you can switch it up on the software and do whatever instrument. So now it's a flute song. So I was thinking I'll play it for you while you you take a look at this crepe piece. Oh, can you hear it? So I think that two things. One is, with that piece, it's togetherness intertwined with individuality, because they're not totally merged together in a way that's codependent, but actually all the notes are played separately. So it's literally interwoven in a way that's not destabilizing, but structured. And I also, when I was looking at this piece, I thought it was interesting how, I don't know, for some reason, the pants of the people, there's a plane going over my head, but the pants of the people reminded me of tree roots. And I really liked that because I think that's grounding. Yeah,